When he cometh, when he cometh to make up his jewels, all his jewels, precious jewels, his loved and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adorning, they will shine. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adorning, they will shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown. Little children who love their Redeemer, all the jewels, precious jewels, his loved and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crown adorning, they will shine.
Thank you. thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. God be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty gain. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art.
We'd like to thank Brother Dennis Robertson for the opening prayer, and now Brother Todd Brown will have a special welcome for us.
I can't think of a more classy or graceful lady than Anne Ford, and yet I can't think of a more tender, compassionate, and godly woman than Granny Anne. It's times like this are very difficult when we lose someone. And we're very thankful for all the family and loved ones that are here to help share these sorrows, to bear these burdens. And so we want to say thank you for coming and welcome. This is Todd and my family here, Rhonda, Malcolm, Sandy, Raquel. We're going to be sharing a song that was one of Papa Glenn and Granny Ann's favorites, and we think that it's very fitting for today's celebration. Sweet Beulah Land.
The following lovely words were penned by Grace Cox, sister-in-law of Anne Ford. And sadly, she cannot be with us today, so I'm going to read them for her. I am Grace Cox, the youngest sister of Anne's deceased husband, Glenn. Or as Anne always called me, her little sister, and to me, she was big sister. These were terms of endearment, as she and I became very close as we got to know each other. Truly, she was a sister of my heart. Most of you who knew Anne well remember her for many things. Perhaps foremost will be for... Perhaps foremost... will be for her God-given gift of hospitality. Glenn had the same gift, and together they made their home a place where people, and I am sure angels, loved to visit. She loved people, and people loved her. But more importantly, Anne loved the Lord. It was His love shining through her that drew people like a magnet. It was joy to be around her, but it was the joy of the Lord that we felt. It was her desire that Christ be lifted up, that she be simply a channel of God's love to everyone within the sphere of her influence. My mother once quoted Glenn as having said to her when he was a young man that he wanted a wife who was as willing to work as he was, though he would never want his wife to actually have to work that hard. And Glenn found a wife in Anne. She was tireless in all her undertakings, throwing herself into the task at hand without reservation, whether it was physical work, visiting people, or her duties as treasurer and other work of the ministry. She never shirked responsibility. We remember Anne for her vibrant energy. Occasionally, however, her energy level did wear thin, and it was at those times that other traits came to the forefront. Sheer determination and a willingness to deny herself for the good of others. Her early morning times with her Heavenly Father strengthened her for each day. What does that remind us of? Christ Himself. Anne loved beauty everywhere, but especially in the natural world. She appreciated nature as God's other book, and she delighted in spending early morning time outside on her second story deck, listening to birdsong and watching the dawn unfold. She took delight in her duties as homemaker and managed to create a little heaven on earth in her surroundings. She was a pastel person, which was reflected in her home decor, creating an ambience of serenity within her walls. Anne was directly involved in the establishment of two ministry projects in her area for the advancement of biblical truth. In the early 1980s, she and Glenn led the push to establish a Seventh-day Adventist church. She and other volunteers worked alongside her husband in the hands-on construction of the Indian Creek Seventh-day Adventist Church building, and she took charge of designing the arrangement and decor of the interior. A few years later, she and Glenn, along with others, spearheaded the establishment of Smyrna Gospel Ministries and the construction of the Sabbath Chapel and adjoining spaces. Again, the pleasing decor testified to her talent for interior design. God loves color and beauty, and all that Anne did in that realm was meant to give glory to the Creator of all lovely things. It was important to Anne that family members stay close with each other. After Glenn passed away, she feared that the family might drift apart, and so she planned a Ford family reunion at her home each year. The goal being to foster ongoing family relationships. She was happily rewarded with a good turnout each year. Due to failing health and strength, she was unable to host the reunion this year. I know that her wish would be that all stay connected and that perhaps someone else will take up the torch and continue to have these annual get-togethers. Anne was a gifted organizer. She loved to organize programs and events. She was often called upon to plan a wedding, a shower, a birthday celebration, and her attention to detail always resulted in a lovely occasion. She wanted to lend her presence to the special occasions that others were planning and celebrating as well. It was important to her to attend weddings and birthdays of grandchildren and others. It was also important to her to spend Thanksgiving with her sister and family in Maryland, and she managed to do so almost every year. Most of us could probably speak of times when Anne was by our side, when we needed a helping hand, a shoulder to cry upon, or a word of encouragement. I know I could speak of many such times. Perhaps we should condense all of the foregoing into a simple nutshell. Anne Ford's life was a life well lived for the Master. Could anyone ask for more? Anne's final days were peaceful, and when it was time for her to go to sleep in Jesus, the Lord allowed her to do so as she had done everything else, quietly, with grace, in sweet tranquility. With eager anticipation, we yearn for the resurrection of God's saints, when we are confident that we will see Anne again. Then she will be in the bloom of health, with eternity stretched before her. I look forward to visiting Anne in her heavenly home, where I've no doubt that angels will be constant visitors. They too will love to bask in the warmth of her loving hospitality that, along with her other gifts, will only grow deeper and broader as eternity unfolds. I don't want to miss it, do you? By God's grace, shall we determine to be there?
Like we did in the service for Kevin, we'd like to have a chance for family and friends to share a little testimony, and we'd like to have the family have a chance first to make sure they are included. But if there's any family that'd like to come up and start out, who'd like to be first, is fine. Who'd like to be first? I know a lot of you got something you want to say. Come on up, Peter.
Good afternoon, everybody. I wanted to thank you all, for each and every one of you, for coming here and attending my Granny Ann service. And as a matter of fact, I wanted to let you all know that the word Granny Ann, when she first started being called Granny Ann, was something that my mom had told me. That when they were getting married, I think, and as they were going down the aisle, and she's like, well, there's your Granny Ann. Say Granny Ann. So, you know, That was back, way back when, back somewhere in the 70s, I think. But, I had talked to her and everything, and I started calling her Granny Ann, and that's where it came from. So all the family that wants to wonder why that she's been called Granny Ann so much, it came from me. My name is Peter, and my brother John's here with his wife Christina, my niece Renee, and also my nephew Justin is here, and my mother here is also here. And I just wanted to let y'all know to thank you very much for coming to her service. I'm not very good at public speaking. I'm a little bit nervous, but you know, that's how it goes. But well, thank you very much. I'm glad you do, because I certainly feel that way right now. Granny Ann had a very good life. You know, she had that gleam and that look in her eye. You knew that she had a way about her and how she communicated with people and how much respect that she had for all these other people. I really miss her a lot. You know, we did get to attend a family reunion, so every chance we had gotten, you know, just going up there and, you know, I know we didn't spend a lot of time with them, but I really am very impressed that we did get to spend the time that we did together with Papaw Glenn, you know, and I remember my great grandma Ford, you know, from way back when in the 70s too, you know, when I was just a little boy. And things like that. And it brings a lot of memories and a lot of good memories that we have. And it's hard to think that she's gone now. It's really kind of settles in my mind, but it's hard to do. I don't know exactly how this is going to turn out for me, but and for each of us too, it's not very easy to see somebody go. But I wanted to be sure to let y'all know that if you ever wondered where Granny Ann came from, it came from me. So I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew that. But and I do appreciate each and every one of y'all for being here today in remembrance of my Granny Ann, or Ann Ford, or Anna Ford as y'all know her. And I really am very pleased that everyone has come here today. And I will go ahead and close for now. I hope that each one of y'all will have a safe trip home. We really do appreciate y'all being here. And I hope that someday that we'll all be up in heaven again soon to see everybody. You know, my Uncle Kevin, my Granny Ann, my Papaw Glenn, and everybody here today. And I thank you very much for being here. And I'll go ahead and close now. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you very much, Peter. I have to confess to you that between the services, that very question was on my mind. When did she really become the Granny Ann? Because I've known Ann for 35 and a half years. And when I first met her, she was Granny Ann then. And so this is nice to know. Who'd like to be next? Come on up, Dan.
Still can't call her Granny Ann. She was Aunt Anna. This is surreal, man. This is surreal. So I don't know if you guys know who I am. I'm actually Daniel. I know that she prayed for me every once in a while. I'm the one that was in recovery. Still am. Aunt Anna had been to both my anniversaries, my first and second year, and I just celebrated my third year, and she was actually in the hospital at the time. And I think she just got there. So I knew. I was like, oh, she does what she always does. She hurts herself, she'll be right back out. Because if you knew Aunt Anna, she would do things 1,000 miles in a minute, you know. She wouldn't stop for anything. I know one time she came down, I think it was the last time she came down for my anniversary, she bumped her hand pretty bad and still came. and didn't tell anybody. And then she got home and apparently she broke her hand. And it was just like, that's Aunt Anna for you. But yeah, this last time, when she was in the hospital, it was definitely, I think I knew, you know, after she'd been there for a week, I knew. I was like, there she ain't. Man, it's just crazy to think about, you know. I knew that she wasn't coming back, you know. I just knew it. She fought a hard fight, man. But so I don't know about you all, but I know that I'm not very religious folk. But when Aunt Anna came around, I was on my best behavior. You know, I may have not agreed with her opinions, and sometimes we didn't have it out, but we talked about it, you know. But when she was around, I was a good little boy. But yeah, you know, it's so we're staying in her house. I haven't been in that house in probably 20 some years, and it's surreal, man. You know, I'm waiting for Aunt Anna to come up and go, that's my boy. Because apparently I was her boy. My mom birthed me, but I was her boy, you know. But yeah, you know, we're the family she always visited on Thanksgiving. And Thanksgiving's in, you know, a few more weeks. And of course, I'm fat, so I want to eat, but still, it's going to be kind of surreal when she comes, and or when she's not there, you know, and we're sitting at the table. Probably just eat pizza or something. That's about right, you know. Don't want to do a whole big meal because she ain't there cooking her stuff. But yeah, man, I really thank y'all for coming out here. I know she touched a lot of y'all's lives, you know, like she said, hospitality, man. Her and my Uncle Glenn, you could be a criminal and she'd be like, come on in, we got room for you, you know. They love you until you loved yourself, basically, you know. Nothing can be said that ain't true about her, man. She was probably one of the greatest human beings I've ever met in my entire life. It's just crazy that I got elected to do this, you know. If y'all knew my past, you'd be like, wow. It's just crazy. But, yeah, man, I really thank you all for praying for me when you guys did, you know, because that definitely led me to the rooms, I believe, in some sort of way, you know. Actually kind of upset because I had my third-year medallion I was going to bring up here in place, you know, next to her and Uncle Glenn. And I didn't get to do that. Of course, you know, true fashion, our family was chaotic, you know. But, man, it's a testament to have all you people here to show how many people she truly touched and loved. You know, you all are family, you know. You might not be blood, but you're definitely family. That's for sure. Annie's going to talk to me now. I can hear it now. But yeah, I really appreciate you all. And before I close, could everybody just give the person next to you a hug? Because I really think Aunt Anna would have really loved that. Thank you for letting me share.
You really appreciate it when you know it comes from the heart like that, don't you? Isn't that beautiful? That's really nice. Is there someone else that'd like to share something? Come on, Patty. Oh, no, Kendall, come to your close. You come on up first, Kendall. I didn't see you when I first called her.
I'm Kendall. I'm one of Granny Ann's many grandchildren / great-grandchildren and whatnot. I remember I was probably like 5 years old, and I would come up for the summertime, usually church meet. And would be after church, a lot of little kids would be running around this, what used to be a slate hole, looking for fossils. And all these kids would just start saying, Granny Ann, Granny Ann, Granny Ann, Granny Ann, Granny Ann. And I'm like, Granny Ann? That's not your guardian. Like, that's migraine again, like migraine again. And that's when I was still kind of getting into, well, you know, that's just what everybody calls her, young, old, doesn't matter, she's granny aunt. So it took me a while to kind of share that. But, you know, Peter said that came from him, so appreciate you sharing that with us. I can remember so many things about granny aunt, but some of the things that really stand out to me would be spending time in her yard planting flowers in her flower beds. This is before she had the top deck, so she just had the swing on the bottom deck. And we would spend many afternoons in between church and on days where we didn't have church, just sitting in that swing, admiring the dogwood tree that used to be in the front yard that I would climb religiously, that ended up having to be cut down. But Granny Ann was, she was an incredible woman. Like they mentioned before, it didn't matter who you were, what your past was. You might get a lecture, but you also got the hospitality part too. She wanted to put you on a straight and narrow, but you know, I think she, of all people, understood that you can't save everyone. You can just try to. One of the days that I visited her in the hospital this last time, sorry, I'm kind of close to the mic, but I kind of had a little, me and one of the nurses kind of had a little, we butted heads a little bit. And I just remember Granny Ann's looking and rolling her eyes, and I could see it in her eyes. I was like, oh, great. Once this tube is out, I'm going to hear it from her about how I was kind of rude to the nurse, but she was rude to me first. So I think Granny Ann was there to witness it, and I kind of felt like she might have been a little lenient considering that it wasn't on me, but I just knew I was going to hear it. I just knew. Like he said before, Granny Ann was notorious for getting hurt and being in and out the hospital or getting hurt, and you wouldn't know it until you'd seen her, and she'd have a cast on her arm or ace bandage or something, and you're like, Granny Ann, what happened? Oh, I was curling my hair and I bumped it on the door handle or this and that. And you're like, okay, well, you're stubborn old mule. And she'd probably not like me saying that, but it's the truth. She was stubborn. The last time that I got to hear Granny Ann's voice, it was the day before she had her surgery. And so it was a Sunday night. We were talking and she sounded good. She was in good spirits. And you know, I said, Granny Ann, I said, you're already tough in your head and your heart. I said, now you just got to get that body tough. And she's like, oh, yeah. She's like, after this is said and done, 3 or so weeks or a month, give or take. She's like, I have a whole new lease on life. And she does. A whole new lease anyways, maybe not be life, but life after death. Her and Uncle Kevin, they were a pair. She, like was mentioned in Uncle Kevin's service, you know, the weekends were kind of like their thing. Like, yeah, you know, it was Sabbath and they have all these church family, but that was kind of a time deemed for them. You know, every Friday he'd go there and then leave Sunday morning. Sometimes I'd visit during the week and I'd want to go visit Granny Ann and he'd be like, oh, well, Kendall, you know, I just spent the weekend there. I don't want to go spend all week there. And I'm like, yeah, right. You know, you love that woman. But really, in all reality, they were just too much alike. They would just butt heads all the time. And then in the ways that they weren't alike, they were really different. So that made for even funnier times. But Granny Ann had the biggest heart, and she loved so many people. I remember being a kid, and during camp meet in the summers, people would come up from, like, literally all over the world. Australia, and I remember sometimes from, like, I can't even think, like New Zealand, all places, everywhere. And she would just tell me about all these people that she'd met from all over the world. And I'm like, wow, like my grandma, those people from like 140 countries, like that's amazing. And I don't know, she just touched lives everywhere. But I remember times, it didn't matter what it was, when speaking on the hospitality part that you guys spoke on. One winter, me and my mom came to visit. And I don't know how or when it happened, but we woke up to probably about 4 foot of snow. Alan, do you remember that? Were you there? And we all got snowed in. We lost power. There was probably like 7 of us, if not more. I can't remember who all was there in that house, but we were all snowed in. Granny Ann luckily had like a little camping stove thing, and we would heat up some food on there and make snow cream on the other times. But rain, shine, sleet, snow, if you were in Granny Ann's home, you were peaceful and you were in comfort, and she made sure that, you know, you were taken care of and you felt the love. It didn't matter if there was 30 people in that house, you walked in it and it was peaceful. It was her sanctuary, and like someone said, it was her little piece of heaven in that holler. But I'm going to let Heidi speak. I appreciate you guys coming out and showing love to Granny Ann. She deserves an exceptional woman, and I know we'll all carry a piece of her in our heart forever. And I hope you guys grab some of the seeds in the back to plant some flowers so next year you guys can see a beautiful ray of yellow and think of her. But, yeah, have a safe trip home.
I don't know how this mic thing works. I think Dan said it best when he said this is pretty surreal. And I guess I just never somehow imagined this day would come. But it's wonderful to see your all's beautiful faces. And I can look at everybody that I know and just think of stories I've heard and all the love that Granny Ann spoke about you guys with. She was always waiting for the next pictures in the mail or the phone call or the visit. And she bragged on everybody that she loved so much. But I tried to think of something I could say today. I wanted to say something, but words seemed so frivolous when I tried to think of how to summarize experiences in a life. And I can't begin to express the love in that way. So I just wanted to say a little bit about what she meant to me. When I was a little girl, my name is Heidi. I'm an adopted granddaughter, and I was her neighbor growing up. And when I was a little girl, she was my Sabbath school teacher and my friend and my granny. And I wanted to be just like her. You know, she was so gracious and she was so tough and strong and energetic and loving. And, you know, when she was older once, she broke a bone and she put on her pantyhose and high heels to go to the ER. And she walked in with a broken ankle, and then she came home and she flushed her pain medicine down the commode. But she always had on those panty heels and high hose and was so beautiful when I was a little girl. And still, I wanted to be just like her. And I remember, I think I was about 6, we had got a garbage bag of hand-me-down clothes. And in it was this suit skirt for like a 6-year-old. And I was so excited because for the first time in my life, I could look like my Granny Ann. And the only thing that I had that went with it was a maroon sweater. So it was a red skirt and a maroon sweater. And I was thrilled, ecstatic. And I came down the steps for church that morning, and Mom said, "Honey, you can't wear that." And I said, "No, but it looks like Granny Ann." I said, "I can't wait to show her." And she finally had to explain to me that Granny Ann would never dream of wearing red and maroon together. And she had to explain to me what clashing colors was. And as an adult, I still don't think I've understood that. But that was the only way she talked me out of wearing my maroon sweater and red skirt. But I'm sorry, I made notes on my phone here because I know I would be really nervous. She always had the house where everybody wanted to be, all the young people, you know. I used to have a few slumber parties when I was growing up at her house. And her only rule was that if we made enough noise that we woke her up, that she was coming to join us. So she always had mint chocolate chip ice cream in the freezer and lots of food and lots of love. And when I was a teenager, she called Dad up one time and said, "Hey, could you send Heidi over here for something?" And so I went over and she said, "Hey, I need to take these vitamin B12 shots, and I was wondering if you could give them to me." And I said, "Wow, I have no idea how to do that, but, you know, I'll try if you explain it." So she explained it to me, and oh my goodness, the torture I caused that poor woman. I think the first time I tried to get it through the skin, the needle didn't even break the skin. And I had to try 2 or 3 times, and I bet it took 10 seconds to put the needle in. I can't imagine how badly it hurt her. And any normal person would have said, "Well, I'll learn to give that to myself," or at least never invited me to do that again. But the next time she needed her shot, she called me up. And she said, "Heidi, you know, there's a program at the Votech School where you can become a CNA and get into nursing." And she said, "I think that you should do that. That would be a really good career for you." And at the time, I think I was 15, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do with my life or, you know, what direction I wanted to go. But I thought, wow, Granny Ann believes in me, and she thinks that this is something that I'd be good at, so I'm going to try that. So I was 15, and we were homeschooling, so I spent my 10th, 11th, and 12th grade. I went through them in a little less than a year so I could start the CNA program when I was 16, because Granny Ann thought that was something I could do. So I never did become a nurse, but I am in medicine, and that all started because Granny Ann let me torture her. pretty much. And, you know, those sessions where I would give her her shots, she would always ask me how I really truly was, not like how my day was going, but how I was, and take those times to encourage me and love on me and give me advice. And I really looked forward to those. But when she was in the hospital in Raleigh General, she had just been in there a day or two, and I went in to see her and take her her peanut butter and banana sandwiches. And she said, "Oh, Heidi, honey, do I have a story to tell you? Come sit down." And she was giggling, and I thought, well, what could this be about? And so I sat down, and oddly enough, the story she was laughing about was about a nurse that came in that tried to start an IV on her. And she said that the man reminded her, he was a comedian on the Carol Burnett show. He had white hair and shuffled his feet. Tim Conway, is that it? She said, "Heidi," she said, "I thought Tim Conway was coming down the hall to start an IV on me." She said, "I heard shuffling feet coming down the hall, and I thought, oh, it must be an elderly," you know, because she didn't never think she was old. "It must be an elderly person coming to visit." And she said it surprised her when in her room shuffled this gentleman. He was a nurse. And she said, It was a little scary. She said he took the saline flush and the IV tubing, and she said he dropped it, and his hands were shaking, and he fumbled, and he dropped it again. And she said it took him a solid 5 minutes to connect that. And she said, "I thought surely he's not going to be the one that starts the IV, but he was." She said the shaking hands continued for the IV start. And that continued not once, but three times in a row. And I said, "Granny Ann," I said, "why didn't you go hide in the bathroom?" I said, "you could have walked in the bathroom and just not came out, and he would have got the idea eventually." And she said, "oh, Heidi, honey, I could never think of hurting that man's feelings like that." She said, "but I did almost ask him if he had ever considered going into respiratory therapy instead." But I've tried to think of, you know, different ways that we could keep Granny Ann's memory alive and honor her. And I've tried to think, you know, I never could paint every room in my house every year a different color and keep up with white picket fences and do all these incredible things that that she did. But I know one time she told me when I was discouraged, she said, "Heidi," she said, "you're not giving your love and your energy away." She said, "all you have to do is sit still and listen to God, and it's His love and His kindness that you're giving away." And she said, "as long as you keep your heart open for that, you'll never run out of love to give away."
I just want to follow up on something Heidi said. When you thought of Ann, you also thought of Glenn. And the thing about them that you remember most was they were prayer warriors. If they told you they were going to pray for you, that wasn't just for a minute. They continued praying until the prayer was answered. And that's something most people forget. With that, I want to talk about a little bit about Anne the person. And to do that, I want to read you a couple of scriptures out of Isaiah 30, verse 15. "For thus saith the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, in returning and rest shall ye be saved. In quietness and confidence shall be your strength." That was Anne. She was a prayer warrior. She spent time with the Father and Son. Now, what good did that do her? Well, in verse 20, "And the Lord give you the bread of adversity and the water of affliction, yet shall not thy teacher be removed unto a corner anymore, but thine eyes shall see thy teacher, and thy ears shall hear a word behind thee, saying, this is the way, walk ye in it." Now, Anne was one that listened to the voice of God. You know, in John 10, 27, Jesus said that his sheep knew his voice, and they were his. And, you know, it's great because, after Anne's passing, one of the men in the congregation talked about when Alan and Ann came up to do a wedding and do baptisms and stuff. One of the young ladies that was getting baptized, her father was sitting next to Ann, and Ann turned to him and said, the Lord just spoke to me and told me to give you this. And she handed him $100 bill and says, please do not tell anyone. This was the kind of person Ann was. She wasn't looking for reward. You know, the scripture says, what you do in silence and quietness, you know, God will openly, you know, return it to you. And this was Ann Ford. You know, she touched everyone's heart. And I'd just like you to remember, if you spend time with your God, he will save you. And he will strengthen you for what's ahead. But be careful. Listen to his voice, no other.
Thank you very much, Brother Ed. It says in the bulletin, I'm supposed to bring you words of comfort and encouragement. And I honestly don't know if I can do either one today. But we're just going to seek the Lord for what we can do and receive. It's been a little more than 10 years ago that we had the funeral for Pawpaw Glenn, Brother Glenn Ford. At that time, I compared Glenn to an oak tree, handsome, strong, enduring. Today we are here to remember his honey bun, our Granny Ann, a beautiful, symmetrical sugar maple. Also strong, but oh so sweet. I suppose we could stay here a long time, even just to try to sum up the life and the spiritual qualities of Ann Ford. There are so many aspects of her life that we could speak about today. So many people's lives she's touched. I've attended a lot of funerals there in Pineville. I don't think I've ever been a funeral that had this many people in it. And that says something, doesn't it? But I've selected just a few things today as representatives of the many things that we could speak about Granny Ann today. And the first point has already been well spoken of, and that's hospitality. The Bible says, let brotherly love continue. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unaware. When we think of Granny Ann, we think of someone who had the gift of hospitality. She loved to entertain and have folks for meals, visiting, and just to stay over. And even when she was 85 years old, she was truly young at heart. And I think she would have joined that slumber party just as quickly at 85 as she would have at 55. She did especially love the young people, and the young folks loved her. She fit into their hearts with an enduring love. And they all felt special, appreciated, loved. And very importantly, they all felt that they were needed by her. Interestingly, in the New Testament, the Greek word that we translate hospitality in many places, it's an interesting word, it's philoxenia. But it's also used in the text I just read to you earlier. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers. That expression, entertain strangers, is from this Greek word, philoxenia, that we translate hospitality. It literally means the love of strangers. The love of strangers. But in the strictest sense of the word, Granny Ann, she really didn't know any strangers, for she was friends almost instantly with everyone that she would meet. When I think of Granny Ann, I think of dedication and loyalty. The Bible says in Proverbs 20, verse 6, everyone talks about how loyal and faithful he is, but just try to find someone who really is. It really is hard to find true friends sometimes, isn't it? Friends who will be loyal and honest, who won't put a knife in your back and twist it. But Anne was certainly a true friend, and she could be a confidant. If you told Granny Anne something, it stayed there. In Proverbs 18, verse 24, the Bible says, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Proverbs 18, 24. We all know that Granny Anne was a person of deep personal conviction, and her dedication to God was deep, but also to her family, to her friends. Few would ever question her loyalty. Her word was her bond. And if she said she was going to do something, even if it was to put those curtains up, and she had to get up on a stand after she'd broken her ankle once doing this, she was going to do it. She always tried to fulfill her word. With Glenn, she helped to establish a church in the Welch Pineville area, and she helped to build two different chapels. Again, she loved young people, and she dedicated a lot of her life to teaching Sabbath school to people like my daughter and others, training a next generation of people. She was very creative. Anne has boxes in her house and at the church of these felts to illustrate Bible scenes, and she would use them so effectively. But sometimes, and Kendall, I'm sorry you missed out on this one, but sometimes if the students were a little too energetic, she would calmly announce that it was time to put our seatbelts on. And she would take an old belt and literally tie the child to their little chair so that they couldn't get up. But she would do it in such a way that it wasn't viewed as punishment, but rather a promotion, because they were getting bigger and going to do grown-up things now. That's pretty clever. Within her family, we all know how loved and dedicated she was and loving. She prayed years and years for Kevin to quit his drinking and to change his ways. And as was noted earlier, God heard and rewarded her prayers. She spent weeks and weeks in the hospital with Kevin when he was in his coma, and then later Glenn after he had his accident. I remember well the day of Glenn's accident. Anne and I were at the top of the hollow at the time, and we got word from a neighbor at the bottom of the hollow that we needed to come down. We weren't told why, but we had an understanding it probably wasn't good. When we got there, it was terrible. But immediately Anne said, "Let's pray." Before Glenn's accident, Anne had talked to me about the need to get Glenn off the road because, you know, Glenn was developing macular degeneration. He just couldn't see as well as he used to. And she said to me one day, "I just don't know what he'll think when I tell him it's time that I have to have his keys." And I looked at her and I said, "I think about the same thing that is going to be said when I tell you that you have to give up your keys." And her head just snapped and looked at me like, "What?" She just couldn't envision that happening. But to Anne's credit, as she got older and her reflexes got a little slower and her eyes got a little dimmer, she gave up most of her night driving and usually allowed Brother Michael to drive her most places, even during the day, Miss Daisy style. Anne was a giving person. The Bible says, "He that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he hath purposed in his heart. So let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. 2 Corinthians 9, 6 and 7. I think based upon this text, God must have loved Anna a lot, because she was certainly a cheerful giver. She and Glenn put their life savings into help building the Indian Creek Church, and then they gave sacrificially for the Smyrna Chapel. I know. But her giving wasn't just to the causes of God, but to many who needed her help. She supported many charities like Cystic Fibrosis, St. Jude's, and others. And she helped numerous young people, especially the youth. And to visit at their home, she would sometimes, in fact, many times, put gas money into the pockets of the grandchildren and others to make sure they got home safe. When I went on mission trips, I could return to find my house repainted, decorated in some way, even sometimes with new furnishings, pastel, of course. For Anne was a woman of taste, and as Heidi said, anyone who could go to the hospital for a broken ankle and stockings and high heels has to be taken seriously. And she just felt that her pastor's poor house needed some upgrading when he wasn't around, whether he agreed with it or not. Anne was a trustworthy person. The Bible says in Proverbs 11:13, a talebearer reveals secrets, but he that is of a faithful spirit concealeth the matter. If you had something confidential that you needed to share with Anne, you knew it would stay there. Your secret stayed secret with her. Granny Anne was also our church treasurer for many years, and I never, ever, not once, worried about a lost penny, or for sure not a stolen penny, while Anne filled that office. If the funds didn't seem to all add up right, she would put her own money into the treasury to make sure that the ledger came out right. Anne was a woman of great courage. To go into open heart surgery at 85 years old, that takes a lot of courage. The Bible says in Psalms 27:14, wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thy heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Anne learned to wait on the Lord, and she could bravely venture out into about anything and any place as long as she knew the Lord would be with her. I remember when I first met Anne years ago, we were in Colwood, West Virginia, down below Welch. We were going door to door during the Christmas season soliciting funds for the poor and the needy. Seventh-day Adventists know this as something they call harvest ingathering. But she could just go right up to those doors and not flinch, no fear. Maybe she had fear, but she didn't show it. But you know, sometimes if you've never been to someone's home before, it can seem a little daunting to go and just knock on a stranger's door and ask him for money. But boy, she, just like an arrow to the target, she would go to the door and she would do that. But she seemed to know no fear. And that reminds me of what John writes in 1 John 4:18. He says, there is no fear in love. There's no fear in love. But perfect love casts out fear, because feareth torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. And I think that she had a lot of love, and that's what helped her not to be fearful to do that. She loved her friends, and she had many of them. It takes love to love people like me, and she loved me like a son. And I think all, you know, I'm not any good today, and I don't care. I don't care. I don't have to be all together today. I don't care. And she would, we'd go places and she would introduce me as her son. And we'd go to the hospital and they'd say, who are you? I'm her son. They say, oh, okay, come on in then. You know, because I was her son. And she was my mother. She went with me on trips sometimes, mission trips, trips to preach to Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, South Carolina, New Hampshire, Arizona, even Jamaica, among other places. This woman, who in her younger years had drank Tom Collins and danced the jitterbug, gave it up to drink fruit smoothies and to have prayer. She worked the last two decades plus as my secretary at the church and the ministry, and I tell you, that took a lot of courage, believe me. Amen. I had a picture I was going to show you. I didn't put it in the slideshow of Ann in stocks, and that might have been what you thought of for working with me. But Ann was full of love, and she was full of courage. And she loved exciting things. She was a go-getter. I remember the time, Sister Annika, that we were in that 4D theater in the Boston Aquarium and how much she just loved that. And then the glass-bottom boat ride we took in Jamaica. And she loved those kind of things. She went whitewater rafting on the New River. I took her whitewater rafting a couple of times. You saw one of the pictures of it. She just loved that. She wanted to go hang gliding and hot air ballooning, but sadly that bucket list didn't get finished. Sister Ann loved our annual camp meetings. And it was, I think, mental torture for her not to be able to personally attend this last year. She watched a lot of it from her home that we live streamed, but she couldn't come over in person. And she'd been to every camp meeting we'd ever had before that. But unknown to her then, and to the rest of us, she had a bad mitral valve in her heart that was causing her to have many issues, breathing issues and other issues that we didn't have the ability to put together at the time. But after we learned what the problem was, again, being brave, she chose to have open heart surgery with the hope of a better quality and quantity of life. Or as it was said, a new lease on life. And she really thought she was going to have it too. I did too. Her time in recovery, it was hard. It was difficult at times. And she had family with her continually, 24/7, during almost all of her 6 weeks of hospitalization. About the only time that someone wasn't with her was when the doctors were doing some procedure or they were bathing her or something like that. But this didn't speak to the goodness of those who sacrificed their time and effort to be there to help care for her and encourage her. Not at all. It spoke about their love for her and how special she was. Repeatedly, nurses and doctors would observe the round clock vigil, and I say literally round clock vigil, that was with her. And they would remark, not, oh, how good you are, but she must be someone very special to family who cares so much for her. And that was so true. At this time, I would like to just acknowledge a few people. A couple of Granny Ann's doctors that were very special people and meant a lot to us. Jacob Meisenheimer was one of Granny Ann's cardiologists, and his wife, Lavina Midalescu, was also a cardiologist, and they spent a lot of time with Ann. And Dr. Jacob came in one day to check on her, and she started to have some issues. And he stayed there over an hour with her, just watching her monitors, making little tweaks, suggestions to do this or that with her medications or something else. He had other patients. He had other things to do. But he wasn't in any hurry. He wanted to help her. His wife, Dr. Milescu, was very good to come in to help and took a special interest in her. And one Sabbath afternoon, she came in just her street clothes. She said, I'm not on today. And of course, these doctors, they work long hours, terribly long hours. And their job is hard. But she said, I just couldn't stay at home today without checking on Ann. I had to. I had to come in and see how she was. There were nurses like Kevin and Jules and others that cared for her and sat by her bedside for hours. Dr. Midalescu texted me after Ann's death, and she said, I'm so sad about all this has happened, and I feel so helpless. You and your beautiful family will always be in my thoughts. Ann touched people in many places and on many levels. Last week, I took this suit to the dry cleaners, this shirt to the dry cleaners, so it could look the best it could. There's a dry cleaners in Beckley. It's called Warnizing. And I've been taking my dry cleaning there for a long time. Ann takes her dry cleaning there. Sister Annika takes her dry cleaning there. There's a really friendly woman. Her name's Rhonda, who works there. And when I went in to take my suit in, Rhonda just, when she saw me, she just bowed her head down and started shaking. I said, "You heard?" She said, "Yeah." She said, "I heard." And she said, "I just cried. I just cried, and I told my husband, I've just lost a good friend." And I started to lose it too at that time. And she came around the counter and gave me a hug that I needed. We've all lost a good friend, a mother, a sister, a grandmother, an aunt. But in a unique way, starting with Peter, we've all lost our Granny Ann. She did have a knack of making us feel that she owned us all, and even more importantly, that we owned her. She was ours, each one of us. We all claimed her for our own. The Apostle Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 19, "If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. If this life was all there was to our existence, we would be miserable to try to live hoping, trusting for something that we would never reach." But beloved, Christians need not be miserable. We can be enduring like oak trees, because the life that Jesus puts within us endures for eternity. We can be sweet like that little sugar maple. We can have lives that are changed, that reach out and touch others and make a difference to other people. And I'd be hard-pressed to tell you of many people I've ever met in my life that touched more people's lives than both Ann and Glenn Ford. And anyone who ever knew that to be true. This life that we live is not the only life for the soul that's hid in Christ Jesus. God has promised eternal life to those who truly love Him, to those who can say, "It is well in my soul." Brother Mike Brown's going to come up and have a musical selection for us, and then I'll have a few closing thoughts and prayer. Brother Michael.
I'm going to be singing "When Peace Like a River." It's also called "It Is Well With My Soul." When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, "It is well, it is well with my soul." Though Satan should buffet, through trials come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate, and hath shed His own blood for my soul. My sin
Oh, the bliss of the glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. And Lord, has the day when the faith shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul.
Thank you, Brother Michael. I appreciated that very much. One of Sister Ann's favorite books was a book entitled The Great Controversy, and those of you who are Seventh-day Adventists are familiar with that book, I'm sure. But one of her favorite inspirational passages is near the end of the book, and I think it's fitting to close off our service with a little reading from it. Speaking about the earth made new, the sweet by and by. It says, pain cannot exist in the atmosphere of heaven. There will be no more tears, no funeral trains, no badges of mourning. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, for the former things are passed away. The inhabitants shall not say, I am sick. The people that dwell therein shall be forgiven their iniquity. There the redeemed shall know, even as they are known, the loves and sympathies which God himself has planted in the soul shall there find truest and sweetest exercise. The pure communion with holy beings, the harmonious social life with the blessed angels and with the faithful ones of all ages who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb, the sacred ties that bind together the whole family in heaven and earth, these help to constitute the happiness of the redeemed. And the years of eternity, as they roll, will bring richer and still more glorious revelations of God and of Christ. As knowledge is progressive, so will love, reverence, and happiness increase. The more men learn of God, the greater will be their admiration of his character. As Jesus opens before them the riches of redemption and the amazing achievements in the great controversy with Satan, the hearts of the ransomed thrill with more fervent devotion and with more rapturous joy. They sweep the harps of gold, and 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of voices unite to swell the mighty chorus of praise. The great controversy is ended. Sin and sinners are no more. The entire universe is clean. One pulse of harmony and gladness beats through the vast creation. From him who created all things, life, flow life and light and gladness throughout the realms of illimitless space. From the minutest atom to the greatest world, all things, animate and inanimate, in their unshadowed beauty and perfect joy, declare that God is love. God is love. I saw that love in Granny Ann's life for myself, for my children, my family, my church family, her family, her friends, every neighbor, every person we would meet. She just had that love. And I want to have more of that kind of love, don't you? I want to be more of that kind of person, don't you? We're going to have prayer, but before we pray, I'd just like to remind you that we would be honored and privileged if every one of you would come over to the chapel to have some fellowship and a meal, to say your goodbyes and your hellos one more time. We will have a little service in the field for Kevin just before that. And if you need to know how to get there, Brother Michael Woodward, Michael, would you hold your hand up in the back there? Michael Woodward there, he'll tell you how to get there, give you the instructions if I'm not available. Just on the other side of Asco Hollow, though, and it's not too far away. And we'll do that. But also, because of my mistake of not turning the microphone on, we're going to need to do a recording of the music and the eulogy for the video. And so those of us who are left after I have the prayer, I would appreciate it if we could sort of dismiss quietly, and if you want to visit out in the hallway up the way, that'd be great. It'll just allow us to get done a little sooner so that we can get back sooner and everything else can progress just a little sooner. So I would appreciate that. But I messed up my knee yesterday and I'm not too good to kneel right now, but I'd like to invite you to bow your heads with me as we pray. Our Father in heaven, Father, we have so much to thank you for. And in our daily lives, we just, you know, we go back and forth in things, and we sometimes forget the little things and the big things both. But I don't think that we'll ever be able to forget Granny Ann. And I don't want to ever forget her either. And I don't think these people want to either. But we thank you that you've been with us today. We've had a lovely service. It's been a blessing to me, and I hope to the other folk here too. But Father, we need your comfort, because when we leave here, we're going to leave some of our family and friends behind. We won't have this togetherness and this unity, and it will be easy to be downcast and feeling like we're alone. And we just ask that you will be with us, each one, especially be with her sister Dorothy. We pray that you will give her special comfort. It's hard to lose a sibling, and we pray for her. For Darlene and losing her aunt, and Kendall, her grandmother, and Judy, her mom, and others that were so close to Granny Ann, many others. And we just pray that you will be with each one and comfort them and comfort her church family too, Father. Give us the strength to continue. We don't know how we're going to go on, except that we know that when Elijah was taken up to heaven in a fiery chariot, you left behind Elisha. And when Moses died on Mount Nebo, you gave the people Joshua. And so, Father, I don't know who you can give us in any way to replace Anne. We'll never have anyone who's truly a replacement for Anne, but we'll have someone who will carry on. And we want to do that. And so we pray that you will fulfill those shoes in whatever way you choose best. But please be with us as we go over to the chapel, or if some have to travel and go back home. Please give us all safety. We want this to be a day of joyful remembrance and good things. We certainly don't want a tragedy or a hardship today of someone being hurt or injured. So please bless each one who travels. Bless those especially who will be traveling a long way. We know there's some who will be traveling back down toward Tennessee and Georgia and many places, and some of them will be traveling a long way. And whether it's today or tomorrow, we ask you'll be with them. I know that's what Anne would do. She would say, we need to pray. We need to ask these people to have safety, and that's what we're doing, Father, and for comfort. And so we just thank you for each one who's here. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you again for being here. This will conclude our service. I hope I can see each face over at the chapel in not just a little bit.